Members, good morning. We have a quorum and this is the appointed time, so I call this meeting to order. Item 1, meeting with the administration. Members, please note that the relevant papers are set out in the agenda for members' reference. About inviting written submissions, based on our discussion at the last meeting, the Bills Committee already published an advertisement on the Legco's website inviting members of the public to provide written submissions to us. The deadline is tomorrow, that is 5 p.m. on the 31st of May 2022. As of this morning, the Secretariat has so far received one submission. And on the 23rd of May, the Secretariat already sent the written submission to members via the email and also requested the administration to give a response. So after the deadline tomorrow, if we receive other written submissions, they will be circulated to members and the administration will be invited to give a response, and afterwards we'll see if we have further questions. Issues raised at the last meeting. The administration has provided responses respectively to issues raised by the legal advisor, members, and members, please refer to CB bracket 4464/2022 bracket 01 and bracket 02 as well as bracket 03. In a moment, I will invite the administration to walk us through the papers, and members, I'll see if you have any response in relation to the administration's written responses, and then we'll move on to clause by clause scrutiny. So let me go through the attendance list with you. We have from the Department of Justice, Ms. Jenny Fong, Deputy Solicitor General Acting, Ms. Peggy Al Young, Senior Assistant Solicitor General Policy Affairs, Ms. Annie Lee, Senior Government Counsel, and Ms. Christina King, Government Counsel, as well as Ms. Selena Lau, Senior Government Counsel, and Ms. Wanda Lam, Government Counsel. So I'll give the floor to the administration. Please walk us through the written response. Yes, the two papers. Yes, arising from the last meeting, you gave us a response on the 27th of May in relation to the list of follow-up actions arising from the meeting on the 17th of May. Yes, the response includes two major points, first on excluded judgments and second on public policy. At the last meeting, Dr. Priscilla Leung expressed concern over public policy in terms of the principle and the circumstances under which a court may set aside the registration of a judgment on the grounds of public policy. So I'll first explain our interpretation of public policy, and then I'll defer to my colleague Peggy to explain the part about excluded judgments. On public policy, we provided the Chinese version of our reply to members this morning. I believe members have already received it. As set out in clause 22.1 of the bill, there are mandatory grounds exhaustively set out for setting aside the registration of a registered judgment. And under clause 22.1J, if the applicant has proved to the satisfaction of the court that the enforcement of the registered judgment is manifestly incompatible with the public policy of Hong Kong, then the court must set aside the registration. This clause reflects Article 12, bracket 2 of the REJ arrangement. The bill has made reference to two relevant registration mechanisms, one under Foreign Judgments Reciprocal Enforcement Ordinance Cap 319, and the other, Mainland Judgments Reciprocal Enforcement Ordinance Cap 597. So these two ordinances are referenced as a blueprint for this registration mechanism. So reference can be made to the judgments made under these two ordinances. But unfortunately, as far as we're aware, there hasn't been any decided case in the context of setting aside registered judgments on public policy grounds. Similarly, there hasn't been any decided case where a Hong Kong court has refused to enforce a non-Hong Kong judgment under common law on the ground of incompatibility with public policy. So under such circumstances, we have to make reference to other information. So we refer to G. Johnston and P. Harris's The Conflict of Laws in Hong Kong. And these two scholars suggested that the incompatibility with public policy ground can be invoked under certain circumstances. Namely, first, it was obtained in violation of a Hong Kong anti-suit injunction. In other words, the court has already imposed an order on the litigant to start a lawsuit, and that the litigant violates that injunction and tries to register this judgment in Hong Kong. And in accordance with this literature, this constitutes a ground of incompatibility with public policy. The second circumstance, it is inconsistent with a previous decision of a competent Hong Kong court in proceedings between the same parties. That is, after a decision has been made by a court of law. So there is inconsistency with a previous decision. And if the judgment of the latter case is to be registered, the court will be violating another principle, that is res judicata. So according to these two scholars, these two circumstances may explain the ground of incompatibility with public policy. Apart from legal literature, we can also refer to cases of arbitration for which judgment has been made out. As we do not have a case law, we consider it helpful to examine the application of this principle in terms of an arbitral award. Our observation in general is that the threshold for incompatibility with public policy is high. That is, using this ground to prove that the judgment should not be registered, or that the registered judgment should be, the registration of the registered judgment should be set aside, and that the threshold is high. So we can turn to arbitral awards and consider whether Clause 22.1J can be considered by a court of law in Hong Kong as a ground for refusal of enforcement of an arbitral award. We have set out our observations in the paper. First of all, refusal of enforcement on the ground of incompatibility with public policy is a residual remedy. In other words, this residual remedy will only be invoked after all remedies have been exhausted, and Hong Kong courts should recognize the validity of decisions of overseas adjudicating bodies as a matter of comity and give effect to them, unless to do so would violate the most basic notions of morality and justice. And in footnote 6, we've provided a case. And in the case cited, in the original court proceedings, the facts alleged in the case have already been argued, and the factual allegation has not been accepted by the court. So if an application is made with the court on factual grounds, that it should not be enforced on the ground of incompatibility with public policy, there must be compelling reasons for the court to refuse enforcement of the judgments. So certain judicial principles will need to be demonstrated in the case. And second ground, there must be compelling reasons to refuse enforcement on public policy ground, which must go beyond the minimum, which would justify setting aside its domestic award and judgments. In addition to comity sensitivity to the need of the cross-border commercial system, or predictability in dispute resolution may require enforcement even on the assumption. So that a contrary result would be forthcoming in a domestic context. These factors will have to be considered, and that the judgment will still have to be enforced. This is laid down in the case Hebei Import and Export Corporation and Polytech Engineering Company Limited. Third point, the ground of public policy should not be widely construed, nor to be sparingly used at random as a catch-all provision when it is convenient, as it is limited in scope. And it is to be sparingly applied. Caution. There has to be substantial injustice, which is so shocking to the court's conscience as to render enforcement repugnant. So that's H and L. Madam Justice Mimi Chan made the above observations in her judgment. Next point, Hong Kong court does not look into the merits of the case or the underlying transactions. Public policy should not be used as a pretext or excuse for the court to review the merits of the award and the correctness of the findings of fact or law made by the arbitral tribunal. So it should not be used as a review, and that it should be so shocking to the court's conscience before this ground can be invoked to set aside the registration.
And in the annex, we have included some examples, and there are three cases that I can explain briefly. The judgment is set aside by the court, and these include the blanket lack of due process in the arbitration process, and there are also unusual facts pointing to sham or illegal contracts. And Annex B, there are three cases that illustrate all these, and all these are cases that are inconsistent with public policy. Of course, there are other reasons involved as well, but that obviously include the public policy and the arbitration award has been set aside. If you look at the Annex B, the first one is the Guangdong Sundang Jinwei Shengbao Yohan Gongxi versus Sunfeng Timber Company Limited. The features we highlight is the abuse of the arbitration process. In this case, the Sunfeng Timber Company Limited, one of the shareholders and directors colluded with another company, the Guangdong Shunde Jinwei Shengbao Yohan Gongxi, by way of signing an onerous contract of supply of marble in an attempt to strip the company of its assets. There are so many ways that the contract was unusual. First, the contract sum was equivalent to 62 times larger than the company's entire sales revenue in 2015. The marble has to be delivered within 6 days of the contract. Failure to do so would render the company liable under a penalty clause for up to RMB $2.2 billion for each day of delay in delivery. Between 2011 and 2015, the annual business turnover of the company was only in the range of between 4.3 million in 2015 and 5.7 million in 2011, with an average annual or monthly turnover of no more than $360,000. So you can see how onerous the contract is. Any delay each day would lead to a fine of $2.2 million. And that's not proportional to the turnover of the company. Under the contract, the deposit of RMB $22 million is supposed to be paid to the company by GD. It was expressed to be discharged by GD's mere deposit of a check for that amount. It was not disputed that the check was never banked in or cashed by the company. The contract was never authorized by the company through its board. Madam Fong, you don't have to go into such minute detail about the case. Right, in this particular case, the legal principle is that the court saw the arbitral process was abused, And the court found that this was against public policy. So the judgment was set aside. The second case I'd like to highlight is ZVY. The legal principle is that there was not sufficient reason given for this arbitration. In paragraph 5, Justice Mimi Chan set aside such order on the ground of public policy, and she held that in bold type, she said that these serious allegations should be thoroughly considered by the tribunal, and the dismissal of such claims should be adequately explained. The reasons may not be short, as long as the factual and legal basis are explained and the reasoning is expressed to enable the parties to understand how and why a finding is made on a material issue and how a conclusion is reached by the tribunal. And Justice Mimi Chan further said that it would offend our court's notions of fairness and justice to enforce the award when it might be tainted by illegality and when a significant issue brought before the tribunal for determination has not been seen to be properly considered and determined, contrary to the party's legitimate and reasonable explanations. And this is against the fair and just notion of the court. So the court would look at the legitimacy and reasonableness of the case. The last case I'd like to highlight is Sun Tian Gang versus Hong Kong and China Gas, Jilin Limited. Sun Tian Gang was serving sentence in the mainland. He was in detention. He may be in detention in mainland, but the arbitration was still going on in Hong Kong. And the other party never informed the arbitral institution that Sun Tian Gang was actually in detention in the mainland. So the other party to the arbitration never had the chance to appear to make representation and to defend himself. So in this regard, the court was of the view that there was a deprivation of the fair opportunity to know the case against him. Now, paragraph 8A, this was shocking to the court's conscience and our fundamental concepts of justice. So we can see that this public policy principle has a very high threshold, and the onus of proof is very high, and is about very unfair situation that left the court really disturbed and shocking to the court's conscience and our fundamental concepts of justice. As to the second part of the paper, the excluded judgment, I defer to my colleague. Let me now explain clauses 5, 6, and 7 regarding excluding the mainland judgments from the mechanism. Before I go into detail about each and every one of them, I'd just like to take members back to have a look at the area that this is applicable. The applicable area is something that we discuss with the mainland, and this is an important area in our discussion. So in 2017-18, and indeed before we entered into the agreement in 2019, we did have a fair amount of consultation. We had regard to the mainland's views and also the input from the stakeholders here in Hong Kong. So when we put in place the applicability, we have regard to the fact that overall we should be able to achieve the result. The result is to cover as much as possible. Now, for civil and commercial matters, we'd like to have a scope which is broad enough, which can be applicable to the stakeholders, and that the scope should be broader than what it is at the present moment. And this is what we are striving to achieve. Now, with this result, with this goal in mind, then we look at the areas that should be excluded. Like I said, having regard to the stakeholders' views, the views of the mainland and the actual needs on the part of both places, we come up with the scope of the bill, and this reflects the consensus. In Annex A, we have a tabulated form which will enable members to understand what the details are all about. Basically, there are a couple of reasons. The first reason is that there are certain issues that are incorporated in the existing mechanism. So instead of this mechanism, in the REJ mechanism, all these issues could be handled by these other mechanisms, and then we don't have to put them under these mechanisms. That's number one. Second, there are differences in the institutions between the two places, and there is no need for us to be verbose about it. Now, with the differences, that doesn't mean that we have to cast aside all the differences. Now, our goal is to cover as much as possible. Despite the differences, we have to consider certain things. We have to consider the differences in the substantive law and also the effect of the application of the law and the differences there. And if there is not enough scope for cooperation, then we will take them out of the mechanism. The first one is, as I said, if the matters are already in the other system, then we will exclude them, like the matrimonial and family cases. This is a case in point, because this is dealt with under the matrimonial arrangement, or other mechanisms can cover like the adoption ordinance, adoption of children. This is covered under the existing mechanism, so we don't really have to put this within the scope of this mechanism. The other thing is separation. The mainland law doesn't recognize the separation in a relationship. So there is no such concept in the mainland. So this is the second principle, that the difference is so wide that we simply cannot accommodate this into the mechanism.
Next point, in relation to estate, I remember last time some members asked about the handling of estate. probate matters are excluded following the second principle because of the fundamental differences in the two legal systems, mostly in Hong Kong. The court must first give a grant in the state, whether intestate or otherwise, before the estate can be handled. Whereas in the mainland, following inheritance law, the eligible party can proceed with probate, only that some administrative procedures will have to be carried out, and that may not involve court's orders. So this is another example of having such a major difference that no reciprocal arrangements can be made. But basically, in terms of estate of the deceased, this can be handled by notaries. The other point is intellectual property. We've excluded infringement on the patent, and this relates to the differences in the two patent grant systems in the two places. So for the time being, we are excluding these cases. The other point is maritime cases, which mostly fall under the first principle. According to the international maritime laws and regulations, Hong Kong, to which Hong Kong is a party, there may be provisions in relation to jurisdictions and other reciprocal enforcement of judgments arrangements. So the mainland and Hong Kong may also have different obligations under the relevant international conventions. And having consulted stakeholders, we believe that they should be excluded. Next, insolvency or bankruptcy. When it's an entity, we call it insolvency. When it's a natural person, we call it bankruptcy. And there are two major areas. In terms of debt restructuring, we signed an agreement in May 2021, and the agreement already covered insolvency of an entity. So this will be excluded under this bill. As for bankruptcy relating to a natural person, the mainland has yet to promulgate a national law on bankruptcy of natural persons. Meanwhile, Shenzhen has promulgated legal provisions in this regard. So it's taking a lead, and maybe gradually the mainland will establish a system or promulgate the law on bankruptcy of natural persons. We'll keep in view the situation. Another area, a natural person's qualification as an elector or voter. It would fall under civil matter in Hong Kong, but in the mainland, it's administrative affairs, so it is not included. There are also other areas in relation to declaration of disappearance or death of a natural person, and determination as to whether somebody is having limited legal capacity for performing civil acts. In fact, we set out in footnote 4 that after disappearance for 7 years in Hong Kong, the person can be presumed to be dead, and it's a point of law in fact in Hong Kong. Whereas in the mainland, one can apply with the court to declare the death of somebody. So this is another fundamental difference, and as a result, we don't think it should be included for the time being. Point number 7, validity of an arbitration agreement or order to be set aside an arbitral award. Again, this has been dealt with under the arbitration arrangement and the supplemental arrangement. So these will be excluded from the bill. And the other point 8, is recognition of a judgment given by, say, if it's a mainland judgment, a court in a place outside of mainland. So it's just like shuffling cards. That is, if you rely on a foreign judgment and seek recognition under this arrangement, this is not the original intent of this bill, because we're talking about reciprocal recognition and enforcement of judgments between the mainland and Hong Kong. So the foreign judgment will be excluded. Point number nine relates to the choice of court arrangement signed in 2006, and parties to the privy to the case can choose Hong Kong court or mainland court to be the court adjudicating the case according to the choice of court arrangement. So for any judgment handed down as a result of this choice of court arrangements, we think that this will follow the same arrangement, because it reflects the choice of autonomy of the litigant. Because the bill has yet come into effect, and the choice of court so made at the time should be respected. That is why for judgments made after the bill has been passed, this will come under the mechanism in the bill. So we've provided 9 examples to illustrate the point. Well, members, please note that earlier the legal advisor put some questions to the administration, and on the 27th of May, the administration prepared a 17-page reply, a very detailed reply to the legal advisor's questions. I don't think I need the administration to go through this response now, but let me ask legal advisor whether we should pay attention to anything in relation to the paper they just went through, or this response. Well, perhaps we can explain the response when we come to the clause-by-clause scrutiny. To give members a better idea, let me read out the names: Dr. Priscilla Leung, Mr. Chan Yong, Mr. Bill Tang, and Ms. Eunice Yong. Each member will be given 4 minutes. We start with Dr. Priscilla Leung. Thank you, Chairman. I thank the administration for explaining the replies in detail to us. I have a question on Clause 22.1J, that is public policy ground. Ms. Jenny Fong just now cited a number of scenarios. For example, the anti-suit injunction, and also the res judicata principle. I don't know whether this relates to 22.1F. I don't know whether this has been made out in Clause 22.1F. That is, in relation to a previous cause of action, a Hong Kong court has already decided on a matter. And if that is the case, that means this is covered. As for deception, is dealt with under Clause 22.1D. Now, you refer to a number of cases, including one judgment handed down by Mr. Justice Bokhari. And I want to know the scope of power of Hong Kong courts. In relation to REJ judgments, of course, in order to have predictability and mutual trust, there should not be any enforcement in the perfect scenario. That is, it's been dragged on for so many years, and the Hong Kong courts have reservations and vice versa for mainland courts in reciprocal enforcement of judgments. So I think the fewer times this is invoked, the better. But I'm not talking about procedural rulings over procedures. Perhaps you're of the view that this should be clearly spelled out and that if you have clear case laws, they should be provided in clause 22.1K or after, so that the mainland courts are also clear that we have very clear legal principles. Because in terms of cases involving the two places, very often for mainland courts and mainland lawyers, they feel trapped. For example, they didn't realize that we still have concubines. So procedurally, I think that it's best if you could spell out everything. But in terms of policy, you need to explain very clearly to both sides. National interests are involved. This may be something yet to come to fruition. Maybe a litigant has signed an agreement to that effect. So I don't think we should just limit ourselves to something so shocking to the court's conscience as in the context of Hong Kong court. Because I don't think this is sufficient in terms of reciprocal arrangements for the two sides. We're talking about things at a more objective level. Just let me finish. It takes a long time for a case to go through in both systems. So, for mainland courts and mainland lawyers, I think they all have eyes on this bill, and that is, should they wish to register a judgment here, they should be able to explain with clarity to their clients. So definitely, this public policy ground goes beyond what you have cited as case laws and illustrated. But then, policy-wise, I don't know, because it relates to the circumstances in Hong Kong, and that's a public policy ground instead of a common law principle. And it doesn't relate to circumstances surrounding an anti-suit injunction. This should be dealt with under the legal principle and should be spelled out as well. It doesn't allow the exercise of any discretion. It should be spelled out clearly here. However, when it comes to public policy in deliberating on the bill, we should labor on this point a bit more. But frankly, I think the court has discretion on this ground. A succinct response, please. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Priscilla Leung. The principle of incompatibility with public policy should not be invoked to deal with procedural impropriety or due process. As I explained just now, it is a residual remedy. If the case involves fraud or undue deprivation of representation in court, these fall under the public policy ground. But then we should aim at things that go beyond public policy. Even if it's just due process, it doesn't contravene public policy, or it doesn't contravene public policy ground. As I explained, it's a very high threshold. In order to prove this ground, to meet this threshold, all we can think of are really exceptional cases. And only under these circumstances would this legal principle be met. And so far, we have not found any decided case in Hong Kong on this point. And that is why we have made reference to arbitral awards in these cases and the legal principles explained for application. Just a follow-up question, Chairman. For fraud, I think this is dealt with under clause 22.1D. It should not come under public policy ground. But as I understand, in all jurisdictions around the world, when it comes to the court's conscience and public policy, definitely it involves public interest. It's not something procedural here. It's something that relates to the grave interest and something really major, so as not to enforce the award or judgment, because this would upset one of the litigating parties. It should not be invoked casually, but it should definitely go beyond what we said just now.
Hi.
Mr. Chen Yong. Chairman, thank you. Thanks very much. I'm DOJ officials. Most of the members of the public, including my constituents, and they are not legal experts. Now we have all the cases for matrimonial cases. If you can cite more examples, then the layman would find it easier to understand. That's point number one. Second, from my constituents, they are particularly concerned about the judgments on both sides. Should they be finalized and before they can make the application? I find that the Mainland judgment, it has to be conclusive, it has to be final before making the application. Now, this is something dear to the heart of the public. If the litigation is still going on, or if the litigation is partially over, they would be really concerned whether they can make the application. I'd like to find out more about it, please. Right, a question and a suggestion. About the family and matrimonial cases, I didn't hear well enough. You said that you like us to explain more to the public the scope of application. And under Section 639, or Cap 639, we have already organized a huge talk, and we've also been invited to explain this particular piece of legislation. And where necessary, we are only too delighted to do more talking, to do more explaining as part of civic education to prepare the stakeholders for the application of this piece of legislation. We are only too pleased to do it. Your second question is about the judgment. Is it subject to no appeal, or is it final before registration can be made? The answer is in the positive. How can we make sure that a Mainland judgment is a final judgment? We really count on the certificate issued by the Mainland, because this certificate will prove that the judgment is valid. Now, by this, we mean there is no appeal, or even if there is an appeal, the expiry, it has gone past the expiry date, or the appeal has been appealed, it has been appealed against, but there is a judgment of second instance. And once this certificate has been issued by the Mainland, we have reason to believe that they have gone through all these procedures and it represents a final judgment. There is another safeguard here. If subsequently it is, or after registration, it is found that the judgment has been overturned, then this can be a ground for cancelling the registration. So there are a couple of safeguards there. Mr. Chen, will you make available some pamphlets regarding the matrimonial cases? There are some precedents, there are some cases. If you can make available more information, then I'm sure that it would be good for reference that would make the public aware of the details. They may not take part in all these talks and seminars. Yes, please, Chairman, if I may supplement. In connection with the matrimonial and family cases, we do have a website. We have a one-stop web page where the background to the legislation, all the rest of the documents and that there are also Q&As for the public. We have published some pamphlets for collection by the members of the public, and these are available at certain institutions. Mr. Bill Tang, Chairman. I'm no legal professional myself, but I am concerned about the REJ myself. That's because the FTU has six service centers in the mainland serving the people of Hong Kong. We have received so many questions and queries from the public. Some are of a legal nature, some are not. The official talked about the matrimonial cases. At our invitation, I'm grateful to them that they have done a lot of explanation. Honestly, for the welfare sector, they are really puzzled about the whole thing, like maintenance, children in a divorce situation. There are so many questions that they have in mind, but they don't know where to approach for an answer. So the mutual recognition and enforcement of the matrimonial judgment, it has gone into effect. How many have made the registration? Second, is the judiciary able to cope? We have 20,000-30,000 cases of divorce every single year. Will you have the capacity to deal with that? Now, these civil and commercial matters would be really all-encompassing, although you have listed the line items there. Will the judiciary have the executive capacity to deal with that? And do you have any statistics regarding the matrimonial cases? I know nothing about the commercial matters, but many people would be locked in arguments over investment in real estate and shops, premises, and so on. Now, if someone thinks that he has an interest in a piece of real estate in the mainland, but this has been embezzled, will he be able to file a suit in Hong Kong? Will he be able to have the judgment enforced in Hong Kong? Lastly, I've put this question before at the briefing. We councillors on the front line know that many members of the public are applying for a lot of benefits, like the grants for universities, the rental housing. If people have assets in the mainland that have not been reported, now there is such a concept of an order to make them repay. Now, can the government the court can order them to make the payment. Can this be enforced in the mainland? Yes, please. Four questions. Thanks very much, Mr. Tang. The first one is about the legislation regarding matrimonial and family cases. In terms of implementation, we do maintain communication with the judiciary. We like to find out about the implementation that this piece of legislation has gone into force on February the 15th. I haven't got to grips with the precise number of cases for the time being, but in terms of the implementation, we would be keeping an eye on the latest situation. Should there be any areas that have been identified for improvement, or should there be any areas that can be coordinated better, we are only too pleased to follow up. As to the executive capability, of course, the judiciary if they need more resources to cope with the registration of mainland judgments, there is a procedure for them to seek extra resources for this purpose. And on this score, we do maintain our communication with the judiciary. For now, they have expressed some concerns, and we will talk to them to see what more assistance can be rendered. And how the Hong Kong judiciary or mainland judiciary, the academics and the practitioners, how they can come together and have more communications in connection with this piece of legislation to talk more about the concepts of the mainland law and so on. If there is anything we can do to help with the workload of the judiciary, we will be only too pleased to do so. You mentioned the real estate. A Hong Kong person, let's say, has purchased a piece of real estate. Can he file a suit and for the judgment to be enforced in the mainland? It's a question of whether Hong Kong court would accept this kind of litigation, or for a court to accept the litigation. There are certain conditions that will be considered, whether the person is a Hong Kong resident, whether both parties are Hong Kong residents or Hong Kong companies, or whether the bone of contention is concluded in Hong Kong, like the sell and purchase agreement, is it concluded in Hong Kong? Or whether the bone of contention has anything to do with Hong Kong? So I'm sure that each case is unique in its own right. So the court will have regard to all these details. If the Hong Kong court has taken on the case and a judgment has been handed down, then the person can take the judgment for enforcement in the mainland in accordance with this bill. The fourth question is, if a person has applied for welfare benefits in Hong Kong and it is suspected that the person owns certain assets in the mainland without actually disclosing the full extent of the assets in mainland to the government, either way he's bamboozling the government, and the government takes criminal investigation, criminal prosecution. And if there is an order for him to pay up, now we have to see that this bill is about civil and commercial matters. If there are orders for him to make payment under the criminal law, and the nature is included in the context of this bill. If the order to pay up is of a compensatory nature, then this Hong Kong court judgment can be taken to the mainland for enforcement. Mr. Tang, you mean the Hong Kong government, right? Will the Hong Kong government be doing so? Ms. Fong? For the Hong Kong SAR government, in terms of student loans and grant, the government is doing a lot of proceedings, and the government is enforcing the right under the law, the contractual right, or the contractual benefits, or contractual right, I should say. With the passage of this bill, there is an avenue to facilitate the enforcement of these rights. I cannot see how the government would be any different in this kind of situation.
Next, Ms. Yunus Yong, please switch on Ms. Yong's mic. Thank you, Chairman. I think we are discussing this administration's reply on public policy ground, and Ms. King just explained that reference has been made to arbitration and conflicts in court and the principles for setting aside the registration of registered judgments. And as explained by the administration, this is not casually invoked because we want to promote reciprocal recognition and enforcement. And if registration can be set aside quite arbitrarily, then this is a departure from what we've been striving for, and we are concerned about abuse. So we need to be cautious about the last point. It is against or incompatibility with public policy in Hong Kong. So I'm wondering, say we have public policy relating to housing, healthcare in Hong Kong, but it seems that it is not the same as abuse of arbitration procedures, non-disclosure set out in the cases in Annex B. And I think that, Chairman, you're concerned, you're familiar with the law of equity as well. I think that these are two different concepts, public policy and the law of equity. When it comes to public policy, say in civil and commercial matters, we find out the policies in Hong Kong relating to commerce and trade, and for example, whether we've signed any agreement with other jurisdictions for enforcement in Hong Kong. So in relation to conflicts with the mainland, how should the conflicts or disputes be resolved in the courts? And I haven't seen any example from what's been provided by the Department of Justice on how they should be dealt with. I think Mr. Chan Yong also expressed concern, for example, for IP-related cases, how do we deal with the conflicts with the mainland? I think that we have mixed up the two concepts. That is, the two concepts. One is public policy, the other is the law of equity. If differential judgments are made, how will the Court of Hong Kong deal with this conflict? You've given us some cases relating to unfairness in the court of law and unfairness in the mainland procedures. Is a court in Hong Kong capable of handling these matters to set aside the registration? Solicitor General, in relation to the conflicts of laws in Hong Kong and the mainland, at a macro level, as far as the framework is concerned, we consider first and foremost the scope of the bill. And as explained by Peggy just now, for matters having great discrepancies in the Hong Kong system and the mainland system, it's difficult to have any reciprocal arrangements, and therefore these issues will be excluded from the bill. So that's the point about scope on enforcement. The role of the courts in Hong Kong is one of registration. The courts do not look at the merits of the case. The courts merely form part of the registration mechanism. As for public policy and other grounds on which the registration is to be set aside, if an applicant applies for the registration to be set aside on public policy ground, the applicant will need to submit evidence to prove that point, and the court will need to consider the evidence in this respect in relation to the legal basis and the facts of the case, and then decide within this legal framework whether the registration should be set aside. Chairman, this is exactly the grey area I've spotted. It's not clear. If there is a dispute on whether the registration should be set aside, then the Hong Kong court may have to consider the point on due process. Now, you've given us some examples. You claim that these are examples on public policy grounds. And if that is the case, in other words, the Hong Kong courts will need to decide on due process and unfairness that is manifestly unfair. So you use the term public policy, but in fact, I think it's what I've referred to, law of equity, that is on the point of equity. So should you change the wording, or let's say another point stemming from this, if a court of law in Hong Kong is required to handle the issue on procedural fairness in the mainland court, I'm just concerned whether we have the power to do so. This is inevitable. That is, if we have an application for registration to be set aside on the grounds that there is due process in the mainland court, or that there is any procedural error in the mainland court, then inevitably the Hong Kong court will need to consider the evidence under this piece of legislation and under this framework, together with the applicable common law principles. The court will need to decide, in the context of the common law system, whether this allegation is justified and whether the registration should be set aside. Mr. Tang Fei, Chairman, good morning, members, good morning. I have similar questions. Having read the bill, well, although at the National People's Congress, the mainland authority have endorsed the codified laws in civil commercial matters, I would say that very different from Hong Kong, they're still in the process of a reform in relation to matrimonial and family law. On the other hand, they have codified the law, and having approved the code at the National People's Congress, I don't think there is, it is likely that the code will change, but then at different executive authorities, there may be administrative rules and regulations revised, and they may also be interpretation of legal provisions, which may fine-tune the implementation and enforcement of matrimonial and family laws. So, as more cases emerge, as the law evolves, and I'm reading the bill here, it seems quite rigid. As long as the mechanism is invoked, this judgment can be enforced. Or can we have the Department of Justice rely on a mechanism to review each and every case and see whether there is any conflict with the legal system in Hong Kong? Because according to what you said just now, parties to litigation or to a dispute can cite grounds on which the judgment is not to be enforced. So instead of following the development on the mainland, you should review the cases one by one, because in that sense, is it that the Hong Kong court is deciding on the fairness and the correctness of mainland judgments? And in that sense, it's not a judicial decision, it's a political interpretation. As you mentioned, there may be changes in the matrimonial and family laws, and in CAP 639, we have dealt with the reciprocal and enforcement arrangements in relation to matrimonial matters and family matters, and it has been excluded from the current bill's application. So we're talking about judgments in civil and commercial matters. The mainland laws may constantly be evolving, and that there may be changes in the mainland laws pursuant to the handing down of a mainland judgment. So how should a Hong Kong court deal with a situation? We want a simple mechanism, one that is for registration. It's not the case that when a mainland judgment arrives in the court of before the court, a court in Hong Kong, we look at the case afresh. That is not our purpose. Our purpose is to set up a simple mechanism so that through simplified procedures, the judgment can be registered for enforcement within a short period of time. And in the registration process, the Hong Kong court does not consider the merits of the judgment. However, when there is an application for the registration to be set aside, if the respondent is able to adduce evidence to support the setting aside of the registration of a registered judgment, then the court will examine in greater detail whether the application is justified. And in the course of that, a court may need to look into greater detail the procedure in a mainland court in arriving at this decision and whether the decision has been made fairly. Each case is supported by its own set of facts. So it's not the case that the Court of Law in Hong Kong will examine the mainland's legal system as a whole. The court may, however, examine the circumstances of that case. You asked another question. If the bill is passed, we will keep in view the implementation of the bill and see if there are major issues. We will, for example, review the statistics, the number of cases specifically, and we'll also liaise with the relevant stakeholders to see if we need to improve the operation mechanism. There are a number of members waiting to ask questions. Now, in relation to the two written responses from the administration, if you have questions, please press the button now. Otherwise, I'm going to draw the line here. Ms. Doreen Kong, Ms. Maggie Chan, Mr. Bill Tang, Dr. Brazil Lang, and Mr. Paul Chair. So that will be the end of the queue. Ms. Kong, Chairman. A number of members mentioned publicity. In fact, I've read this bill a number of times. I think this is a rather complex bill. And I think even as lawyers, and I believe my fellow lawyers here will agree that this is not a simple bill. And the administration just explained that the pamphlets would be printed, but I don't think preparing pamphlets are enough. I think it's difficult to put in all the details in a single pamphlet. So what you need to do is to hold seminars for the public. And there shouldn't be only one seminar together with the REJ on matrimonial and family matters. You should hold seminars not for professionals, but for the general public. And you need to visit every district. And I'm grateful in relation to this bill. You've spent so much time in drawing up this bill. But it's a very good one, having had so many meetings, even here in Lechko, having put our heads together. At the end of the day, the bill cannot be properly enforced because the public doesn't don't understand. So you need to have seminars, and perhaps you can enlist the help of trade associations, community organizations, labor unions, so that more talks and seminars can be held for the public to understand the issues.
In terms of family and matrimonial issues, like you said, you did talks and seminars, but these are intended for experts. The members of the public are not aware of that, and I hope that you will be able to publicize this bill to the members of the public. Thank you. All right. Any comments? Thanks very much, Madam Kong. We do appreciate that the members of the public do need to know more about this bill. We will take on board Ms. Kong's views. Ms. Maggie Chen. Chairman, thank you. Also, on the question of public policy, this Mainland Judgments in Civil and Commercial Matters Reciprocal Enforcement Bill must be on the basis of mutual respect and predictability. The paper mentions there is no substantive injustice. So this bill is to avoid a situation that one has to litigate on both places. But if there are people who abuse the legal process and manipulate the time and they may be taking advantage of the judicial system in both places and file the litigation between the two places, there is no notification between the judicial or the judiciaries. If for the same case, both sides or the courts on both places are taking on these cases, and there may be some people with ulterior motive who are trying to shop around, and they are filing the proceedings on both places. Is there any consideration being given to this, or has the, in terms of public policy, have you tried to stop people abusing these procedures? Now, we may not see this happening to registrations, but in terms of setting aside the registrations, if some people were to say that they are trying to repeatedly file the proceedings on both jurisdictions to achieve their own ulterior motive. Now, you said you would look at the cases yourself. Now, how are you going to deal with these kind of abuses? And have you also considered all these measures, issues? This is the first question. The second question is, would you consider having a notification between the judiciaries on both sides? Yes, Ms. Fong. Thank you, Ms. Chen. In connection with the issue of people abusing the legal procedures, there are a number of ways to deal with this. If parties to a course of action would like to bring proceedings in Hong Kong, then they have to prove that they have connection in Hong Kong, or the issue in question have to do with Hong Kong. And that's the first line of defense, that there can be no abuse of a jurisdiction to get a judgment, or they cannot abuse any legal procedures to get a judgment. In the context of this bill, there are a couple of things that can deal with this. First, for the same course of action, if there is already a judgment in Hong Kong, I'm pushed for time. Now, this gray area, people, we don't actually have a judgment yet handed down on either side. Right, Ms. Fong. So the parties to the course of action will have to make an application. In Hong Kong, if proceedings are going on, in the mainland, the proceedings are also going on, the parties to the course of action can make representation with the court that the Hong Kong proceedings should not continue because the proceedings are already going on in the mainland, or vice versa. They can say to the mainland that the proceedings should not go on because there is a parallel proceedings going on in Hong Kong. So it's up to the court to decide which court will have the jurisdiction. So the parties to the course of action will have to argue over that. If either party or either side has already handed down the judgment, then under this mechanism, they can make the registration at the opposite court. For the Hong Kong court, if you are trying to register a mainland judgment, whereas there is the same course of action in Hong Kong, then the course of action or the litigation in Hong Kong will have to be stayed to guard against any parallel proceedings. Ms. Chen, if courts on both sides all claim that they have the jurisdiction, and assuming that both have handed down the judgments, maybe a couple of days apart, and someone is trying to set aside the registration, then this is an abuse of the system. So is this against public policy, as you referred to earlier on? Make it brief, please. Ms. Fong. If the motive is improper, and if there is an abuse of the legal process, then under 22.1J, one can satisfy the court that there is such an abuse on the basis of public policy. Ms. Chen, well, this is a tough question, isn't it? So at the end of the day, the judiciaries between Hong Kong and the mainland should establish a communication mechanism, because otherwise the issue will never get resolved. Mr. Paul Jay, very quickly, in response to Ms. Kong's point that she's very committed to publicizing the whole thing by suggesting some seminars and talks, but I would have thought that some infographics would be a lot better, and people really find it difficult to understand all these minor details unless they are the interested parties. I think more effectively, the government should explain these to the public. I welcome Ms. Doreen Kong to join me to reach out to the public to bring them up to date about the situation. Now, coming back to the public interests. In the reply, para 11, it seems that there is a mention of the threshold being very high. It would be hard for the judgment to be overturned. Now, there are three cases cited by the administration or under the purview of Justice Mimi Chan. They are pretty special cases, but they happen quite a lot, actually. Like some one of the parties has been detained, and the civil proceedings are going on in Hong Kong, and the plaintiff doesn't really inform the court, and the other party was kept in the dark. It's more like a judgment in absentia. This is pretty blatant. Now, we heard a lot about these stories on the front line. Or there may be some collusion between companies. Before winding up, they would try to create some false contracts to get rid of the assets. Frontline lawyers have heard a lot about these cases to a certain extent to decide whether these judgments should be set aside. They should have regard to this situation. Justice Mimi Chan said or mentioned that there is some a breach of Hong Kong's justice, so much so that the judgment cannot be upheld. Now, in actual fact, in arbitration, there are such three cases. I think it was Mr. Bill Tang, or Mr. Tang Fei, beg your pardon, who said that it's not simply a question of the judgment. The Hong Kong court is actually questioning the validity or the legitimacy of the mainland judgment. I'm not going that far in the mainland. They have been putting in a lot of effort to improve the judicial system. And since the civil code has been in place, and they have put in place a very good system, things are improving, but there are some old cases involving some remote or courts in remote places. The quality varies quite a bit. I say this not because I'm against this bill. I just like to go on record to say that we are very concerned about these issues, and I hope that the law enforcement agency or the DOJ would understand that it's not as if we haven't considered all these issues. We just like to take the first step, and we very much like to take a step at a time. And I hope that with the passage of this bill, we have really had these issues in mind. Do you want a response? Right, please take note of Mr. Paul Jay's comments. Mr. Bill Tang, please. Chairman, thank you. Still a couple of questions, if I may. Also, this is all-encompassing, and I hope that the judiciary would have sufficient manpower, sufficient capacity to cope with the workload. Ms. Fong said a moment ago that the judiciary also expressed some concerns. My position is that I'm all in support of this bill because we really want to help Hong Kong develop into an international legal and arbitration center because we don't really want to get bogged down on this particular bill alone because of the manpower crunch. It is hard to get into the mainland these days, but there is a backlog of cases involving real estate and other disputes, and people simply cannot make their way to the mainland and they lose the case. Given the constraints now, have you really talked with the ministries and commissions in the mainland because of the closed border in Hong Kong? Would there be any implications on the people of Hong Kong? I don't think this is going to be long term. But have you taken up with the mainland there?
Second, about national law, this point was raised by Mr. Tang Fei just now. But as you explained just now, in Shenzhen, as an international commerce and trade center, there are legal provisions only applicable to Shenzhen. So would there be disputes? Say, if this judgment can only be enforced in Shenzhen, not even in Guangzhou, and if they apply to be registered in Hong Kong, do you have a way to handle that? The other point, as put by other colleagues, do you have a review mechanism? I am not suggesting it should come to a halt in full, but let's say if this mechanism in future is unable to deal with the whole variety of cases that may emerge in the future, is there a review mechanism? The other point is about this registration of judgments in commercial matters in Hong Kong, and that's a mainland judgment. And the other point is for a Hong Kong judgment to be registered right after it's been handed down for enforcement in the mainland. And I don't see, in short, any performance pledge here when the registration process will be completed. I don't see anything in the bill. Can we have a performance pledge together with the fees? Can you prescribe the fees? The other point, say if there is a contractual dispute and a party wins the award in the mainland, and I just read a clause about payment, and then a party may only register the judgment in the mainland only when the exchange rate is in his favor. SG, about backlog of cases in Hong Kong, and that there may be problems as a result of our not being able to have quarantine-free travel with the mainland. The Hong Kong parties cannot attend hearings, and so far we have not heard any concern expressed by stakeholders as a systemic issue. I mean, in some cases, indeed, some Hong Kongers may not be able to take part in the legal proceedings, but it's not a problem that requires the Hong Kong government to give a systemic response. Now, you ask questions mostly relating to the differences between the Hong Kong laws and the mainland laws. On the point of bankruptcy of a natural person, at the moment, in the mainland, there is no national law governing the bankruptcy of a natural person. So for matters which constitute a fundamental difference between the two systems, the issue will be excluded from the application of the bill because we are not able to deal with this fundamental difference. There is no starting point for us to work on. However, it doesn't mean we exclude anything that is different from our system. Say, if the difference is not a major one, it may still be covered by the bill. It's a matter of give and take as far as the bill goes. We need to accept that there are differences in both legal systems, and that when the mainland judgment is to be registered in Hong Kong, the legal concepts entailed in the judgment may be different from Hong Kong. But according to the registration mechanism here, we will still register this mainland judgment. In the same vein, according to judicial interpretation, the mainland courts will implement the same arrangement. It will give recognition to the fact that some legal concepts in the Hong Kong judgment may not be consistent with their legal principles. So it's a reciprocal mechanism on which we deal with the discrepancies between the two systems. Is there any way to suspend this mechanism? Well, we'll continue to keep in view its operation. And if the bill is passed, reciprocal and enforcement of judgments in the two places will be handled according to the bill. We'll keep in view the implementation details. There may be certain adaptation along the lines of, say, expanding the scope of judgments to be covered in the bill. So unless we encounter major difficulties in the future, the bill will remain effective if it is passed. On the matter of validity period, a mainland judgment can only be registered in Hong Kong if there is any default in payment, and that there is a time limit of 2 years, beyond which no registration can be made under this bill. On the issue of fees, rules will be made in due course, and the registration fees will be prescribed in the rules. And if a certificate is applied for in Hong Kong for registration of the Hong Kong judgment in the mainland, the applicable fees will also be prescribed in the rules. About settling the payment in Hong Kong dollars, if there is an application for registration in Hong Kong and if the award is made out in renminbi, then the effective exchange rate of the day will apply, and that the order will prescribe the payment in Hong Kong dollar on the day when the judgment is processed in Hong Kong. So again, we need to look at the time limit, and of course someone can consider how he can get the maximizes interest, but he also needs to consider this time limit. Next, Dr. Priscilla Leung.
Thank you, Chairman. I would still like to go back on Clause 22.1J. Now, the crux of the bill is reciprocal enforcement. You mentioned Mr. Justice Bukhari's remarks, and I think that this is closest to the principle of the bill. Apart from predictability of cross-boundary issues, the matter should still be enforced even if it is predicted in contrary of the interests in a domestic sense. So I'm not trying to give you an exception. I just want to say that in terms of public policy, at the end of the day, it's up to a court to make judgment and exercise discretion. You mentioned the point about anti-suit injunction. I want to know whether you can include this expressly in the table. And also in paragraph 11 of your reply, you referred to some cases, in particular the Hebei case. It was in 1991, and back then there was a prevailing resentment of reciprocal recognition, and you talked about basic notions of morality and justice. and I don't think it reflects public policy. Public policy is my name, public policy. It's not other all-inclusive principles of the common law or equity law or case laws. It's a matter of policy. The courts will only need to decide at the most critical juncture, and that there should be compelling reasons to do so. This is a 1999 case, and we're in 2022. Having explained these different cases, I think that it may be a too narrow interpretation of the public policy ground. So at the end of the day, it's up to a court to decide on the basis of the law and this bill and public policy ground. For anti-suit injunction, how about include that expressly in the table as well? And so point C, you've explained under what circumstances it is not to be accepted, that it should be spelled out very clearly that there would be no registration. So instead of elaborating on an existing point, you should just spell it out very clearly. For the benefit of litigants as well as lawyers. Just list them out. If you need other clauses beyond K, you should do so. Just put down very clearly that it doesn't work for anti-suit injunction. I'll defer to Ms. Aoyang. Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Dr. Leung, for making this point. And of course, on public policy ground, ultimately it's for the court to decide. This is the last remedy for the for the court. And in fact, we have explained in the response that the threshold is high, and that only special circumstances warrant the consideration of this ground. In terms of this mechanism is excluded in the interpretation. And for mainland judgment, we also exclude interim relief. Right, so if it's excluded, you should not list it as an example of public policy. Yes, we try to explain in the paper that we do not have any judgment in the context of CAP 319 or CAP 597. We then make reference to scholars' literature as well as other cases in the context of arbitration, and this is rather a detailed interpretation of this matter. As for anti-suit injunction, it's not within the framework, and we've excluded the definition as well. Now, Dr. Leung, you mentioned the problems of serving notice and fraud. These are set out in Clause 22. So basically, we have clearly provided for the scenarios in the. For example, we have C, Clause 22, C and D, and about serving of notice, so on and so forth. Res judicata, it's been dealt with in this clause as well. So by listing all these subclauses, we show that it's actually the residual remedy, and the ultimate decision lies with the court. So you should make it clear that you have dealt with anti-suit injunction, and it's not under public policy ground. So public policy ground relates only to public policy. It doesn't relate to all the question, all the issues raised earlier. Right, I'll stop the queue. in relation to the two written replies provided by the administration. I'll stop, allow questions on them. We now move on to the class-by-class scrutiny. Members, please refer to the marked-up copy and also the bill itself. And I'll ask the administration to take us through the bill.
Let's take the Chinese version first. Madam Ao Yang, please. I will do it together, both bilingually, maybe. Chairman, should we start with long title? Chairman, should we start with long title? Basically, the purpose of the bill is enshrined in the long title. We need to have a registration system to implement the arrangement back, entered into in 2019. We've already said that we deal with the issue of assisting how the person can obtain the certificate for implementation in the mainland. That's about the long title. Any questions there? Please. Part 1, Clause 1, short title and commencement. The commencement will be announced by a notice in the Gazette. We said before, and we say again, that this is to implement the 2019 agreement. This is a reciprocal recognition and enforcement. So there will be a simultaneous commencement. We will maintain communication with the mainland once this is put in passed. We will announce a commencement date on both sides. As we said, after the passage of the bill, we are going to have the rules. The draft has been put out for consultation. There, with the passage of the bill, there may be some amendments to the rules. And thereafter, the SJ will publish the commencement date by a notice in the Gazette. Ms. Carmen Khan, about this commencement, there are two conditions. The first one is there will be, that this is reciprocal enforcement of the judgment. The mainland will also recognize and enforce the judgments in Hong Kong. They will be making their own preparation for that as well. That's condition number one. And second, the consultation on the rules. So how will this be implemented? There are no preconditions. This is a date to be decided upon by the SJ. Yes, we're also concerned about how to implement the bill. We will follow the established mechanism. There will be sufficient room. With the passage of the bill, we will be communicating with the legal profession and the judiciary, because at the end of the day, it will be, well, the good thing is we have all the rules there, and we have received comments from the stakeholders, and we are almost done with the rules. And with the passage of the bill, we will be fine-tuning the bill, the rules, to make them make them perfect. So it would take anything up to 6 or 7 months in the light of our experience with regard to the Metropolitan Family Bill. And in Mainland, they have the judicial interpretation for these to be brought into force. And we're working very hard to make preparation for the commencement of this bill. And we don't see the need to reduce it to writing in sufficient detail. Ms. Khan, during the resumption of second reading debate, will the SJ be mentioning these two conditions for reference? Chairman, all these legislative provisions in the bill we haven't seen the principles of the SPC. Can we make the assumption that they will be mirroring what is in the bill? Otherwise, we are merely looking at how we recognize and enforce the Mainland judgments. But on the flip side of the coin is how will they do so? Now, maybe in terms of public interest, they will hand the judgment on the basis of their own and interest. If we are not proceeding in tandem, it will be out of sync. Ms. Ao Yang, thank you. Prior to the commencement, the SJ, during the second reading of the bill, we would suggest that the SJ refer to these kind of information. The second issue is the implementation of this arrangement in the Mainland. Members can rest assured that we have entered into all these MLA agreements with the Mainland, and they would publish a judicial interpretation for the commencement. And we entered into the agreement in 2019. We can anticipate that this is only from our perspective, of course. So that the agreement will be in line with the agreement. You might notice that the terminology that they will use is closer to the Mainland, but there may be a bit of fine-tuning in terms of the bill. But the content tallies with the agreement. For the Mainland, it's up to their own arrangement. Ms. Khan, a more desirable way forward is we should see how the Supreme People's Court will implement this. Maybe they have the consultation document. Then we know the scope of their proposal. And the 2019 agreement is more like in principle. And we have enriched the agreement. We have adapted this to the Hong Kong situation. So surely, we're not just replicating the arrangement onto this bill. I'm sure that the DOJ has done an awful lot of work. The bill, after scrutiny, after passage, will become law. If we cannot see the consultation document or the bill in the Mainland, then it is really out of sync. Have you talked with an SPC in the Mainland? After signing the agreement, we do maintain communication with the SPC. Of course, they are concerned about our timing. They have the judicial interpretation, as I said. As to whether they will publish any consultation document, whether they will do any consultation, it's entirely their prerogative. We do understand that we are concerned about this. Our stakeholders are concerned about this. In the light of previous practice, the SPC may not necessarily do so, because their judicial interpretation would be consistent with the agreement. As to the courts at the provincial or municipality level, how do they do the capacity building? How do they conduct the training to make sure that after the judicial interpretation, how the law will be implemented? This is something that we are concerned about as well. So we can do more in the way of the stakeholders, and we can face, or we can look at the different courts first, and then we will look at the stakeholders, the practitioners in Hong Kong, and we can communicate with the SPC and the mainland to see whether we can do a better job in this regard. I'll extend the meeting by 15 minutes to get this course out of the way, and we'll bring the meeting to a close. Mr. Paul Jay, I'd like to find out more. Has the SPC done the judicial interpretation? Ms. Fong, no, they haven't. It doesn't take long for them to do so. Our scrutiny might take a longer period of time. In other words, they are still awaiting us, and we're telling them that the bill is about to be passed to set their mind at ease. This is not the first agreement that we entered into with the mainland judiciary, and this is a ninth bill involving the civil and commercial matters. So we have built up a very good foundation. So we will try to dovetail better. And we also like to do a better job in the way of communication with the public. Mr. Jay, now with the passage of the bill, to the time they issued the judicial interpretation, what is the lead time like? The SPC doesn't lead a long time. Can you quantify how long? 3 months, 6 months, or what? Ms. Fong, a couple of months. But from the passage of the bill, we take longer than this time frame. Taking the matrimonial case, for instance, it took us 6 to 7 months. So the time taken by us would be longer than that taken by the SPC. But we will maintain good communication. We will keep the public well informed. Mr. Jay, I'm not sure whether I've got it omitted anything. When is it going to be the commencement day for this bill? Now, subject to the bill being passed, in the light of the matrimonial bill, it would take 6 to 7 months to bring this into effect. Mr. Jay, there will not be any transitional provisions, are there? I'm thinking the frontline practitioners might think that if there are judgments that will be enforced in Hong Kong or vice versa, they may stay the proceedings. Is there such a likelihood? Ms. Au Yong. Now, this bill will apply to the litigation after the commencement of the bill. As to how they make their choice, it's up to the people involved. Mr. Jay, well, the commencement date may not be cast in stone, but if you have some projected date or anticipated date, then the practitioners will consider whether it is when it will be in the best interest to schedule the timing. At least you should give some definitive timing for people to understand the situation better. Any further questions?
If not, I think we have to bring this to a close. We continue with more of the same next meeting. Any other business? Date of the next meeting. The clerk has given me some dates. June 6, Monday, 2:30 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. Any comments on this date? If not, then we so decide June 6, Monday, 2:30 to 4:30 for the next meeting. Unless there are any further questions, meeting is now adjourned. Thank you all very much.